Okay? Now answer this question about if we come across people who are in cultic churches. How should we approach it? I think we can approach it with questions like, are you sure about you're saved, that you can go to heaven? And then, why are you sure about your salvation? And what do you believe about God, and how's your relationship with God? Now, I want to say this, when someone is already in a cultic church, his mind is already there. We want to change their mind because they're following something wrong. But if we just tell them your church is cultic, it's not going to work. And also he can go back to the church and tell the church that this Christian from another church tell me that your church is cultic. It can cause problems. Although, you know, if some churches are clearly cultic or satanic, we're not afraid to tell people that this church has problem. But when this person is already believing something, usually it's very hard to change the mind. And if we want to change the mind, we have to use scripture to ask them, what does this Bible passage say? So according to this Bible passage, how should we follow God? So it's better to try to change them by the Bible. And then when they are convinced, they start to change their mind. The same applies if two persons are dating and one person it's also hasn't having adultery. You try to convince this person is your friend is committing adultery, don't stay with him or her. You just tell him not to do it, and to forsake the other person, he won't listen. Because when somebody does something, he has a reason and he has a habit of doing it. We have to help this person to gradually understand. So what I said is from one step 1 to step 100, you cannot just jump to 100. You jump from step 1 to 2 and 3, but slowly on. That you let him know that, you know, for instance, someone is having, dating someone is having adultery, and then you ask him, you know, what do you think about the future? To start him thinking. And then for someone in the cultic church, we want him to bring him to think about the Bible verse. And then also at the same time we can ask this question. What is the basis of our faith? Is it from scripture or from people? If the scripture says something but people say something different, do we follow the Bible or people? So when people are convinced that, yes, we follow the Bible, not people, also we can bring this up. You want to have salvation from Jesus. So do you want to follow Jesus' word or someone's word? And then if someone's words is against the Bible, what does it say about those people? So this our approach, the understanding that these people are already in a way brainwashed. Now I want to say that for some cults, they have brainwashed the people, they against any Christians convincing them to change. I have talked with many Jehovah Witnesses. And the Mormons, or call the Church of the Latter-day Saints. I found that when I talk with them, it's like talking to a wall. They totally, you know, would reject any kind of truth from the Bible. And then they also have a habit. When you talk about one passage, they will jump to another one. And then I tell them, stay in this passage. But very often they don't listen. And also their interpretation of certain passages can be twisted. For instance, Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6 that, you know, a baby has been born for us. And his name is Almighty God. Then they would say, this is just one mighty God, not the Almighty God of the universe. And also they say that, well, God, how can God have baby? So they use human logic to deny that. Or some people say, how can God, you know, if God doesn't have a wife, how can he have a wife, a child? But Jesus is the Son of God, not the sense that at one point he did not exist and then God gave birth and then Jesus came out. Because Jesus existed forever and ever, there was no beginning of Jesus. So from this teaching, we know that Jesus is the Son of God. It doesn't mean God gave birth to him, but it means a relationship, like a father to the son, a relationship. Okay.